modern man has turned his entire world into a monstrous, flaming arsenal. To protect himself against the inhuman forces of his own invention, he hides behind 1,000 masks and disguises. Rudely turning his back on the profound but simple miracle of his own being, he has put his faith in gigantic, complex machines. He cannot live without them. Ignoring his own pure strength, he stares, spellbound and frightened, at a world he can no longer understand. Is there an opportunity for men to act as men, free and unencumbered by science and their own inventions? Luckily, there is. Luckily, 15 days out of every 1,461 are donated to an international holiday, the Olympic Games. Australia. What is it exactly? A continent? An island. Almost as large as the United States, it has fewer inhabitants than New York City. Is it really a continent? And Melbourne. Like the previous sites of the Olympic Games, is it an international capital, like London, Los Angeles, or Berlin? Melbourne is hardly more than a provincial town, capital of Australia's smallest state. Population, just over 1 million. Named after a British prime minister. It's just a town, improvised, ad-libbed by an English traveler. Ad-libbed by John Batman exactly 120 years ago. John Batman fought off 1,000 kinds of wild animals and built a village. Original name, Dutagala. Today, Melbourne. This year, the world's oldest celebration, the Olympic Games, is taking place in the world's youngest city. Now, for the first time in history, the games will be played in the Southern Hemisphere. And when they are through, Christmas, observed outdoors in the heat of summer. Instead of coming down chimneys, Santa Claus rides ashore on a surfboard. There's another thing about Melbourne, no back streets. But there are suburbs, miles and miles of suburbs, spreading in all directions. Here, in this cottage, there's a charming young woman. Her name is Shirley Strickland, and she is 30 years old. Her favorite pastime? Running the 80-meter low hurdles. 4 years ago, she was awarded the Olympic title in Helsinki. Now she is listening to the planes flying overhead. Planes bringing other young women from all parts of the world. Women with the sole intention of taking her title away. Here's John Landy, holder of the world record for the mile. He's also hard at work. He'll be competing in the 1500 meters against the finest athletes in the world. But whether the name is Landy or not, this is not merely another competition. These are the Olympic Games. And more than any single victory, the hopes of all are for faster games, higher games, farther games, better games. To Australians, this is Texas. But there are no cowboys, no Indians, no wild horses. Just tame sheep. And a high jump champion named Porter. Fly low over this Australian panhandle. It might be the Great Plains. But you'll find no prairie dogs here. Koala bears instead. Technically, they're marsupials. They spend most of their time sleeping in eucalyptus trees. You'll find no buffalo either. But kangaroos. And more kangaroos. Thanks to the government, kangaroos feel perfectly safe going anywhere. And there are no lariats. But the famous boomerang. Once a deadly weapon, it is now just a game taught to the tourists. Sports are taken very seriously here. This woman is dressed for bowling, Australian bowling. The rules are very strict, right down to the uniform, and they are followed to the letter. For some reason, Australian women prefer sports to backfence gossiping. And their children are brought up to think the same. This spirit, this love of sports, more than anything else, marks Australia as the most natural place on earth to play host to the world's finest athletes. And that same woman, the bowler, will be the first in the stadium on opening day. Trains are overflowing with spectators. The planes will unload whole cargoes of international celebrity. On opening day, the competitors will assemble on the lawn before the stadium. Each delegation has its own formation. It's just like a parade. And for the Australians, a long-awaited dream is coming true. A miracle is in the making. The Australian Army Band provides the fanfare of 15 exciting days to come. Ordinarily, automobiles are not allowed on an Olympic track. But this one carries the Duke of Edinburgh. He'll preside over the games.
But the Grand Marshal, the honorary captain, is Jesse Owens, winner of four gold medals, all in 1 year, 1936. Protocol calls for the delegations to parade around the track in alphabetical order, but Greece leads it off.
And this is no meaningless compliment, for above all else, it is the beauty and glory of ancient Greece that is on display here in Melbourne. Oddly enough, the games have been canceled 6 times in the last 1600 years, all because of war. And yet, during the times of the Golden Greek Empire, the games went on uninterrupted year after year for exactly 1,170 years. It took more than a war in those days.
This pretty girl is from Colombia, South America. She came all the way to Australia just to march in the parade. The magic of the Olympic Games could bring East and West Germans together under the same flag. India sent only one woman to Melbourne, and it won't be her good looks alone that will attract so much attention during her race. These seven Liberians have come all the way from their native Africa in the hopes of winning gold medals. It isn't just hope that the Americans brought with them, however, but confidence. There's no doubt that the Army Band will know the Star-Spangled Banner by heart before very long. Their chief rivals, as in international politics, are the Russians. They're outmatched in most of the track and field events, but they are patient and good. Finally, the hosts. Ordinarily marching near the head of the parade, they come last after their guests. With a population 20 times smaller than the United States, 25 times smaller than Russia, the Australians will more than make up for it by winning several gold medals.
The Duke of Edinburgh was about to officially open the games.
Melbourne, celebrating the 16th Olympiad of the modern era.
The flag bearer, he's fainted. Was it emotion that made him drop like that? Believe it or not, it's the heat. It's scorching hot on this 22nd of November. Pigeons, off to spread the word. The games are beginning. The sacred flame, lit in Greece some 12,000 miles away, carried halfway around the world by teams of runners in relay.
Thank you.
Here's Landy again, holder of the 358 mile, taking the Olympic oath in the name of all the athletes here.
By the rules which govern them, for the glory of sport and the honor of our country.
A few arenas. That's all that's left of the earliest Olympic Games. But this stadium was especially rebuilt for these games. It's one of the most modern in the world. Though there are 120,000 seats, each one is at a premium. The usually calm suburbs will be overrun. Nobody can hope for a spectacle like this in his own backyard, no more than once in a lifetime. Every day a new bill, a new act, and with new stars. For the first time in history, the games will be televised, but not the complete games. For the athletes, on the field, are not the only participants present. Another drama goes on in the boxes and the bleachers of the stadium. The spectators, faithful to the end, sitting all day for 15 days, fighting off hunger and the heat. It's almost as if they too are in training for the games. The ushers are all members of the Australian Navy, each one playing cabin boy now. It takes patience to be an Olympian. Most of the time you sit and wait, camping out on the great center field. There was a time when an arena meant cruelty and martyrdom. Those days are gone. Nevertheless, there'll be more than enough pain experienced today. For every champion crowned, there'll be dozens of young men defeated, eliminated, rejected. Some of the men will actually cry, and most of the girls. Some of the events are killing. The 3,000 meter steeplechase, for instance.
It's the hurdles mainly. They're so taxing that the winner, Chris Brasher, an Englishman, will barely be able to cross the finish line. When he finally does, he learns he's been disqualified. There's a happy ending, though. The decision is reversed, and he's awarded his gold medal, accompanied by God Save the Queen. The losers fall by the wayside. Sometimes it's just an unlucky accident. Bobby Morrow. From San Benito, Texas, he's carrying his own starting block, a favorite to take the 100 and 200 meter sprints. Every runner has his own particular ritual to perform before the race. Morrow pays special attention to the condition of the track. Like Owens, who won in 1936 wearing tennis shoes, Morrow knows the importance of testing the cinder track. This final preparation gives him an opportunity to both concentrate and relax by letting him forget, if only for a few seconds, the race which is about to start. He waits until the last minute to remove his jacket, as if the very contact with the air might dissipate the speed he's been building up inside. He wants to hoard it all for the moment the starting gun goes off.
Each athlete gives to his own particular area of the field is shared by the sweepers and the other groundkeepers. But the officials and judges have a more precise job to perform, like measuring the speed of the wind. If it's too strong, records cannot be declared official. And as much as anything else, records are important to the Olympic Games.
Semifinals for the 100 meters. This is Germar, a German. He's the only European able to give the Americans a run for it. America's Ira Murchison wins, but Germar is third, thereby qualifying for the finals.